Actually, I came to visit this building that you all know. And I thought about the title, Local Global, that it's maybe a good start, you know, to start here in Bratislava with a building. And the reason why I'm interested specifically in this building is that I made a competition 1 year ago in Hangzhou for the art campus. It was a program of more than 100,000 square meters. This was the plot. And it was extremely ambitious program, as quite often in China, with a very devastating result in the end. And the question was, how could the Bauhaus in our century look like? Or the School of Wuchtemas. and we thought maybe we should not start with the building itself, but we should start with the landscape and say that in our times maybe the building should be something that just landed in a landscape. It's not the landscape that is just surrounding a settlement of buildings. So there should be an inversion of these two elements that you will find, of course, in every campus. And we propose this kind of wetland, which is purely used in an agricultural way by fish ponds and different fields for rice and other things. And we thought that the building, you know, like the TV station, they could just be an additional element that just touches with a very small footprint these wetlands. I have to admit the structure in is much nicer here. I mean, not in our project, but here in Bratislava. But it was also just a concept design, and later on we got some feedback. This is another version, which I actually preferred. You know, like a cloud. That the buildings are lifted something like 40 meters, and you would just have glazed elevators and staircases going up. however, the jury was not entirely satisfied with our proposal. And one of the problems we had is that they had a huge ambition for sport fields. And if you want to make a running track, you need a deck of 120 meters by 60 meters and some football fields, some tennis courts, some basketball fields. And this actually gave the outline of the building on the roof. While the building started much, much smaller, with a footprint of only 6,000 square meters, and would slowly grow up to 20,000 square meters. This is now a footprint with 20,000. The whole structure was thought that you would have every fourth floor as a steel truss, and all the elements in between, they are just suspended or standing, and it's like a temporary installation, you know, that could be also changed on the long term. And we also thought it would be nice if this huge building is not just served with elevators, but that you can walk around it in front of the facade. There is a longitudinal cascading system of stairways, and you could also have the fire escape stairs always in the middle like tubes going up on both sides and being connected to the stairs outside. So that even if the form might be extremely monumental, that the life inside would be everything, but monumental would be dominated by short path walks around and through the building. It's more like a network of stairs than a hierarchical system. This is, you know, how we could imagine some art classes inside, or some research area. And what a surprise we lost. But let's say if this would be built, you know, I mean, not only my career would have went another direction, but also China would have, you know, a totally different impact on, let's say, what is architecture today and what could be the meaning also of sustainability, which more or less is how we use it today, an alibi to just continue wasting resources like the landscape that we built on. In this sense, it's also a structure that solves a problem, you know, by changing its form and outline with the height. You know, I want really to stick to this topic of global local. Somehow, I mean, we have a small office, something like 10 people, but we work in different parts of the world. And it's so easy, you know, with a mobile phone, you constantly can be in different places of this planet every time. And I could show this map, you know, to say, well, there is where it all started, where the office is, and this is where the places where we worked. And it looks like a map, you know, of enterprise kind of expanding over the world. very successful international career or something. But actually, the reality is a totally different one. Most or all of these projects far away, they will never be built. But somehow you could also... Oh, how do I get back? Somehow you could also say that... without these projects, without the experience of these projects, other projects could not be possible. And in this sense, to work abroad is maybe has the biggest advantage that you don't know really where you work. And this gives you a freedom because you can imagine, you know, how China should look like or how China could look like. That's much more difficult for me, let's say, with Switzerland or Germany, because I know how these countries look like, I know how they work, I know how the juries work, and this makes me slave, you know. To imagine how you could live in a favela is much more exciting just because I don't know how you really live there. And what I would like to show you now, if you're not already too tired, is some relations, you know, how projects abroad influenced other projects. And of course, it doesn't mean you develop something for another country and then you just take the same solution and build it somewhere else. This would be rather, let's say, the McDonald's principle or the principle how a office of a star architect might work. But it's more getting engaged in a totally different context, bringing the expertise, experience back, and through that, having other possibilities to act on a certain context. This is a tower in Paris, which you probably know, and this was very influential for New York. Most of the tall buildings in the 20s, they try to reach exactly this altitude. But if you look how Eiffel managed to achieve that with how little material, it's much more advanced than all the high-rise buildings that came later. And one of the reasons is that it's built on triangles, which is the most efficient way to get stiffness. And a high-rise building is not very difficult to bring down the loads, but it's extremely demanding for wind loads, earthquakes, for lateral forces. Therefore, you could also imagine a box, a normal high-rise building, filled with triangles. And this is our proposal for Zhengzhou. As you can see that we have triangles with different heights. And this means that you have in the lower area a much higher density in the upper than in the upper area. It also means, of course, that the point where the column meets the slab always changes. And in this sense, the grid of the beams is in every on every slab different. This means that the core is not anymore the most important stiffening element, and it has not to be in the center of the building. It can be on the side. It gives you plenty of freedom. This is just the biggest size that you can have without dividing a floor area for fire security. And you can look through the building on all sides. This is supposed to be a movie. Yeah, it doesn't work, obviously. Okay. Well. What you see is that the diameter of the columns, they don't change. Even if the building is 120 meters tall, the diameter is just 20 centimeters. But the intensity of structural elements changes throughout the entire building. And you have the highest density on the ground floor. Okay, this was also never built. We did all together for Zhengzhou something like 7 proposals. I don't know if they built anything there. But we were approached from the Kingdom of Bahrain to make a proposal for a pavilion for the World Expo in Dubai. This is a picture of the World Expo. They expect 25 million visitors in half a year. And I think our plot is here. And I never was to a World Expo. It's not exactly about architecture. It's a kind of a Disneyland of you know, all possible countries. And the topic is inventing the future, connecting the worlds. This is Bahrain. It's a small island. It has a lot of variation. If you drive from a Formula One race track to the Burial Mules, which means crossing 4,000 years of culture, it just takes you 20 minutes. So there's a lot of variety on a very small space. And this density was something that interested us a lot, and that we thought we should somehow present also in Dubai. There are several projects from the Ministry of Culture and Heritage as preserving old houses in an area called Muharraq. And between these ancient houses, you find buildings by Anne Holtrop or Valerio Olciati. And this is the plot for the pavilion. And we thought maybe, you know, it is not really the best place to make an object or a garden or anything like that, but maybe more relate to the old history of the architecture in Bahrain through a solution with courtyards. So we propose one courtyard, 1,000 square meters big, 25 meters high, buried in the ground. You have to access it through a ramp leading down over a length of 60 meters. So that if you are in this hall, that you have really long distance, let's say from this very noisy neighborhood. I was very much fascinated by these old townhouses. These are houses where you don't see outside into a garden, but they are, because of the heat, quite closed, and the only openings you have are these grids that you see for the ventilation. And these ornaments interested me a lot. This is an ornament from Bahrain, and you could tell that it's slightly different than Islamic ornaments because it's a bit more irregular, it's not totally symmetrical. And he thought, well, maybe it would be nice, you know, to build a house like that, a house like an ornament that is not just, or a space that is not just empty, you know, but it's extremely dense with elements inside, and of course it was never thought as a drawing in one surface, but of course as a space. And these columns, they touch each other several times because it's so crowded with these structural elements. So what you get in structural terms is a reduction of the buckling length from, let's say, 30, 35 meters down to 6 meters, which allows us to have the whole structure for this 1,000 square meter big space with tubes of 11.4 centimeters. This also was supposed to be a movie. Anyway, the thing that interested us is, you know, that you create in the, let's say, desert or also in this exhibition area, a space where people could meet, come together, But a space that is not just a void, that is not empty, but that is like filled, that is densified, but not with heavy elements, but very light ones that slightly touch each other. And the windows, they are inclined due to the inclination of the structural elements. They are just the consequence of these sticks that would stick through them. So in this sense, there is a certain, let's say, common interest that we maybe started to develop with the high-rise building due to the desire to reduce the thickness in high-rise structures or also the weight of high-rise buildings. But one could also say that this space is much purer because it doesn't have any slabs and because the windows are a consequence of the structure inside. So in this sense, it's of course going much, much further than this initial design. Starting again in China, Guangzhou, a city that has as many visitors as Paris. Sometimes we were wondering why. This is a huge plot for three museums, and we thought it's a unique chance, you know, to build not just an object and the surrounding, but to build all at once and to think of the building as let's say like rocks in a landscape, as parts of the natural landscape environment and not as part of the city. So we thought in terms how to work with, let's say, organic geometry. And these models might look quite weird and maybe look convincing in terms of landscape decoration. But you might wonder, how the hell can you make a space in these things, you know? And I show you now one of these models from inside. This is a model, scale 1 to 200, and we put some people, some artwork, some landscape elements, and as you can see, the topic of the building was to create an exterior space inside the building. To say the building is just an extension of the park. It's not an object that is kind of taking, diminishing the scale of the park, but on the contrary, expanding this dimension. this is a look inside, a look from outside. This is not the building itself. It's just these spheres which touch and interfere and create an interior space. But also the outside is actually built on the shape of shells, as you can see here. And again, competition failed, totally boring project one, one of these projects that make you wonder why the heck did they made a competition at all, because it's not so difficult to get a boring project on the free market. Still, let's say, it was the first time in the office that we just started with models, also through this desire to more work out of the landscape space. And the model in the end became the architecture. And this experience to relate so closely together a model workshop and in the end architectural design was quite important for a totally different project for the Venice Biennale 2015. I don't know if you have ever been to the Biennale in Venice. I'm always disappointed if I go there. And this is the place where I would kind of try to recover after half a day and spend the rest of the day. A coffee shop at San Marco. And it's not, you know, that there are bad architects making exhibitions, but the problem is a different one, you know. This is real. This is a real space. This is real architecture. And what you see at the Biennale, most of the time, it's not at all, you know. You just look at some drawings, some material laying on the floor, or but it's not what you really enjoy, you know, in architecture, the real built space. So from the start, it was clear we would love to build something, you know, for Venice, not just show something or explain something or so. This house from Marcel Breuer was built in the courtyard of the MoMA, and it was a propagandistic exhibition for the new way of living, of modern architecture. And there's a problem with this house, you know, it's not real. You could say it's like a drawing, it's like a model, or it's like a video, you know. It's a representation of a house for a family, which is not a house for a family, but an exhibition object. So in this sense, there's like a logical problem. How can you create a space that is not representing something else than itself? And the only way to do that is to do something which you cannot understand. So we started to make models, but not like architects, you know, with plywood panels or cardboard or sticks, or I mean things that you also would find in reality, but things that you use more for cooking or maybe in chemistry then you actually use it in an architectural office. This is a picture of the studio at the ETH. There were the favorite materials in the end were dust, sugar, wax, dirt, because all these materials have no form, you know. They have no precise outline. And the model started like that I was totally frustrated and said, look, all you did so far is really terrible. And if you would make a plaster model of what is here in this trash underneath the table, it would be 100 times better. And of course, I didn't mean it like that, but one of the interns took me very serious. And the next day, he would show this model, and I was totally enthusiastic, you know, because he took whatever he found in the garbage and put it and made a cast out of plaster of it. And then from there on was like the question, what, you know, we called it incidental space, but of course it's everything but incidental, because we did over 200 models, you know, to just find out which is the best one and the right one. And all these models are not only different in terms of form, of shape, but also totally different in terms of texture. And to control this, we made mock-ups with photography on the wall. to get a feeling, you know, what in the end is the texture of the ornament of the space. And I quickly run through how we build it in the end. This is the physical model, which was cut into pieces that we could scan it. This is the scan. And this is then the element that is cast in fiber concrete out of a plotted foam work. And we produced approximately 200 elements in a workshop and then have them shipped to Venice and put them together. And, you know, computer technology, robotics is extremely precise. So we were always dreaming of having joints of, well, does it really have to be 3 millimeters? What about just having it 2 millimeters? In the end, we ended up with joints up to 7 centimeters. But as you can see, they all disappeared. This is the surface outside the building and the surface where the people in the workshop would put the concrete on top of the formwork, while inside you have the very precise surface, which was directly connected to the formwork. And the Swiss Pavilion is quite small, you know, and actually it's consisting of 3 different spaces, and even the biggest one is quite small. So if you make a space inside that space, you know, the problem is it will be quite small in the end. And the interesting thing is this building has more or less a surface of 20 square meters. But if you look at that picture, you would never tell, oh, this is a space of 20 square meters, right? And the reason is the eye cannot anymore tell the scale because it has so many different information. It has so many different textures, forms, shapes, and you cannot see the end of the space, you know. There's always a side behind what you see. So that you nearly have the impression that you are in an endless space. And of course, it was meant to be a space that doesn't remind you of anything, a space that does not exist anywhere else than at the Biennale, a space that if you would have not visited it in reality, you could not imagine. But in the end, whatever is new, whatever is strange, people give a name to it, you know, to make it cozy, to make it approachable. And at least we got 2 names, you know. From outside it was called the cloud, inside it was called the cavern. But if you imagine a cloud that becomes a cavern, or a cavern that becomes a cloud, already, you know, this is at least a new combination. Last project. My mother is Brazilian, and well, she didn't grow up exactly in a favela, rather on the opposite. So I was always kind of fascinated by favelas, also from all the stories I heard, like if you enter it, you get shot right away and so on. It made me also spend 2 weeks wandering around the favela, you know, like, and I have to say I enjoyed it. And of course there are a lot of stories like of crime and poverty and so on, but one has to understand that the favela is also self-built by people that are proud that they built their own houses. And that these houses are also kind of a resistance against crime. And I was only once not allowed to enter the favela, and that was on a Saturday morning, because on the Saturday morning all the rich kids come to the favela to buy drugs, and they don't want to be found themselves on a picture by doing so. But otherwise, how close people live, you see here four entrance doors next to each other. The two in the middle are from houses behind or above of the houses that have the entrance doors on the left and on the right. And these small scale spaces that constantly change were extremely fascinating for me because it's, let's say, a different quality than we have in our own towns, or that, let's say, Italian cities would have. But it's a different quality, you know? It's not worse, it's not better, it's just different. We also made a research on this housing. This is from a PhD, Hugo Mesquita, that was in every single apartment that you see here on this map, and even drawing exactly how people would live there. And this work was crucial for our own work. And initially, the city of Sao Paulo asked us to, you know, make something like a favela upgrading. But I like the favela so much, I just told them I cannot make an upgrade. You know, it's like being asked to make an upgrade of the Piazza San Marco. You know, it's different, but it has very specific qualities. So we proposed to make the expansion of the favela. And of course, we improved certain things a little bit, like, for example, the distances of the houses became a bit bigger. The density is also bigger. It's about 2.5. Normally, you find a density of 1.5. Floor area ratio, but let's say the project was also something like an homage to the favela. You know, it was not kind of pretending, we make everything new and we teach the people how they should live and do things differently, but in the opposite, you know, just to say, could we also do it artificially? Could we also plan a favela? And the outside spaces look extremely, full of variations, contrasts, constantly changing, and also chaotic, you could say. But if you look at this plan, you see that there are only five colors of houses. And these are the five typologies. There are actually only five houses designed for these 450 units. But each unit is repeated 90 times. So in this sense, it's extremely systematic, it's extremely simple, but the appearance is a totally different one. And this actually brings me quite close to Bratislava, to Prague, where there is now a building under construction, House Okamura. The plot is quite nice. It's Prague 6. But let's say, the neighborhood, you could think in different terms. It's not a very wide view, but it was not so much the plot, you know. To be honest, I think architects always explain their projects through the plot, you know, like they were victims of the plot. But I mean, in the plot, you just look for the arguments to do what you want to do, to be honest. And I think this was shortly after this project in Parisopolis also failed. I think it was for the 7th or 8th time. I think it died altogether about 20 times. And there was this discovery of, let's say, the small spaces. We called them atomized spaces. And we thought, well, maybe we should approach once a private residential commission by having each space as a house. So each space is circular, it's totally round, you know. In this sense, it's totally autonomous, as if there would be not any other spaces in that house. But more than this form, for us, what's interesting that if you imagine a house built of many small spaces, and the house has only 3 apartments between 90 and 120 square meters, but it has 52 rooms, that through each door you would see something different, you know. So the flashes always show your connection, like, you know, if you look outside here, you see this space. If you look through this door, you see this space, and so on. And this, let's say, labyrinthic quality was the main interest. This now is the same floor plan that leads to this other kind of scheme that you saw previously. These are the floor plans of the same apartment on the other levels. These are all 3 levels of the house. And you see that the area where, for example, the blue apartment is, changes with the height of the building. And if you look very closely at the scheme, you know, how the spaces are organized, which are the views, which are the connections, how you can walk from one space to the other, on the different levels, you actually will discover also quite a strong relationship with the design of Parisopolis, where we put together these 5 different houses in different ways. So maybe we would make a block of 2 or 3 or 5 units, and this would lead us to this, let's say, schematic reading of the model and the plans that you just saw previously. Now it already has 2 levels, and it will have altogether 3. Thank you very much.